Let's discuss how we tend to let peer pressure influence our reasoning more than we'd like to admit. This phenomenon becomes even worse in the age of social media, because the format of Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, and other social media networks rewards impulsiveness, presents shallow content, and does not challenge pre-existing views. It feels good to have your views mirrored back, rather than being challenged and invited to reconsider your position. It feels good to tell people what they want to hear and get thousands of likes and shares and retweets, which in turn spreads your message even farther. I mean, you work hard all day, and you just want to use the internet to relax and look at cute kitty pictures. Why bother with the stress of confronting your own blind spots and perceptive flaws? This is why we think this video may make some viewers angry, even if it's just about video games. If this video is making you angry, please consider that we are only trying to put a mirror in front of you, and that you shouldn't blame the mirror itself if you see something you don't like. So now, to get to the topic of fighting games, many of us are really passionate about the genre and put a lot of time into improving at the games, discovering and sharing information, organizing community events, helping other players, etc. We sometimes engage in a destructive behavior that ultimately undermines our efforts. Here are two base assumptions that we hope most of us can agree on. 1. Having many valid options to choose from in the genre, a variety of games with active communities, is better than only having a single dominating title. Not everyone is going to like this specific title for many possible reasons, and it's good that the norm is to offer several options rather than just one. 2. As a hardcore scene, we need to acknowledge that not all aspects of a game deserve equal weight when judging how good a game is. If someone says Tekken is a bad game because mashing kicks with Eddie is too good, do we accept this opinion as valid? Or should we openly express how this opinion should not have the same merit as opinions that come from high-level experience with the game, especially when they don't just come with blanket statements, but also with concrete solutions to back them up? I'm not just saying that mashing kicks with Eddie is not strong. I'm also showing you that if you wait for this specific animation, you can low parry and punish with big damage. As another example, let's say Tekken 8 comes out, and in terms of mechanics, roster balance, and overall depth, it's 10 times better than all of its predecessors. But in this game, Jin Kazama's eyes are blue, instead of whatever color they were previously. Imagine if many players started saying, "This game is garbage and not worth playing because Jin's eyes are blue." Obviously, we can't tell people what to like and why, but we can't really promote playing fighting games competitively and delving deep into their depth while pretending that Jin's eye color is just as important to the gaming experience as all the other aspects of the game combined. So if having more valid options in the genre is a good thing, and we don't want our game of choice to be judged over insignificant reasons like one of the character's eye color, then why are we doing this to so many other games? The most prominent example in recent years is Marvel vs. Capcom Infinite. We can pretend all day that what's important in a fighting game is the mechanics and how deep it is at high level. But let's face it, the internet decided the game was bad before it even came out, and everything that followed was just excuses to help justify those initial baseless convictions. Chun-Li's face before release? We're not going to say her face looked good, because it did not, but it's not like you were staring at it during an actual match. Do a couple of scenes in the story mode you play through once, if at all, affect the experience this much? Street Fighter V also has its fair share of ugly faces, and there was far less controversy about them. NetherRealm games have weird animations all over the place, but it never managed to hurt their sales nor their competitive scenes, far from it. And if visuals are so important to warrant such an outcry, why aren't these people playing the fighting games with the best visuals? At this point, people could say they had 20 additional better reasons to dismiss the game, and those reasons may be extremely valid, but you cannot deny that the loudest criticisms were not related to the game's depth. Was this treatment just? If MVCI is a bad game, shouldn't the focus at least be on the absolute most important aspects of why it's bad? Let's look at various games that got somewhat similar treatment in the past. King of Fighters 14. Here the visuals were, for many players, an overall downgrade from the beautiful and expensive to produce 2D art of 13 to make the production of the game financially feasible. But you are not playing KOF over other games just for visuals, right? Are the mechanics better than 13 or not? Is the cast more balanced or not? Most people will never find out. Dead or Alive 5. The DOA series is infamous for its fan service, and people just assumed it's mechanically shallow. They judged a book by its cover, and treated DOA players like a bunch of horny teenagers who should be playing real fighting games instead. What gives you the right to pass judgment if you can't even be bothered to find out how good the game is mechanically? While not all titles in the DOA series were top-notch, DOA 5 is a good game that offers something a bit different from other titles. But the stigma already prevented many people from approaching it with an open mind, and maybe finding a game they could enjoy. Virtua Fighter. The stigma of the series was a double-edged sword, with the negatives outweighing the positives. It's so, like, deep and stuff. So deep that you need to have a PhD just to begin to appreciate it. Was the stereotype based on truth? Somewhat. VF4 at high level required you to buffer 3 different throw escapes into your sidestep, and Akira had an important move which required you to let go of a button after exactly 1 frame. But let's get real. Most of us don't decide to play games based on what we'll need to do at a grand finals 5 years from now, and not all characters are as technical as Akira. VF5 changed the throw system to avoid the need to buffer 3 different throw inputs, but the stigma still stuck. Even games like Guilty Gear are still suffering from a hard-to-play stigma, despite Exord replacing demanding mechanics like FRCs. To make matters worse, all of this happened while Street Fighter IV was praised for being so accessible to play, despite its heavy reliance on hard links and an awkward yet mandatory cancel mechanic. In so many cases, the little things, which are forgiven as non-issues in popular titles, are blown way out of proportion, and it can be argued that word of mouth prevented these games from being as successful as their merits warranted. If you don't want your preferred game to be one day dismissed because of silly reasons like a character's eye color, don't let hysteria over non-issues dominate the discussion, and don't let other games be thrown under the bus when you can clearly see that it's not justified. Think for yourself, explore the topic, ask questions, get informed, and correct misinformation. Treat others like you want to be treated yourself. That's all there is to it. Hopefully we've at least managed to get you to consider our position. Let us know what you think in the comments. If you play a more niche game, can you recall times when you or the game itself were treated unfairly? Please share your experiences below. Thank you for watching, and see you next time!
何が出るかな?